Hey guys, welcome to all of you on our channel, that is Achieve IAS. So friends, as you know that on our channel we are targeting the exam of civil services, and for that purpose we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So in this video we will be talking about our daily current affair MCQs based series, in which what we do, we take up daily 10 questions, basically MCQs from the current affairs of the day. So today is 21st August, so let's start the discussion, the MCQs of today. Consider the following statements related to United Nations Security Council. First, there are 15 permanent members in the UN Security Council. Second, only 5 permanent members have veto power. So here we have to choose that which of the above statements is correct. So let me tell you friends that the first statement is incorrect, because there not 15 permanent members are there in UNSC, but there are 5 permanent members and 10 are non-permanent members. So these 5 permanent members enjoy veto power. So only second is correct, so the answer would be B. So here is the explanation. So basically this agency of United Nations is given the task of maintaining international peace and security. So it has different powers, and please note that it is the only UN body with the authority to issue binding resolutions to member states. That is, there is no other UN body or any other body that can give binding resolutions to member states, but this has the power. So 5 permanent members, you might be knowing: Russia, UK, France, China and United States. So it has also 10 permanent members, and presidency rotates among its monthly among its members. So role is to basically maintain international peace and security, and it is the only UN body to issue binding resolutions, and it also establishes the sanctions, or for that matter military action, peacekeeping operations or military action through Security Council resolutions. So let's move on to the second question. Second question is, consider the following statements related to the proposed draft National Resource Sufficiency Policy. First, it proposes to set up National Resource Sufficiency Authority under Ministry of Power, and members from other countries form part of it. Second is, it also offers zero tax benefits on recycled materials, interest-free green loans to small and medium enterprises. So which of the above statements is correct? So we have to choose that which of the above statement is correct. Let me tell you friends that both of these statements are incorrect, because this draft National Resource Efficiency Policy, though it is in it is proposed, but the body, that is National Resource Efficiency Authority, it is proposed to be set up under Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, and not under Ministry of Power. And it does talk about offering tax benefits, but that doesn't mean that it will offer zero tax benefit on recycled material. So both the statements are incorrect. So draft National Resource Efficient Policy is basically aims to promote the efficient use of resources. So please note this word, efficient use of the resources with minimum negative impact on environment. So I will be just giving you a brief idea, because here entire discussion about the policy is different, difficult. So this policy is basically aiming at efficient usage of resources. That is how the resources are utilized in different government departments, or for that matter in entire economy. That is by reuse, that is by recycle, and that is by this refurbishment, remanufacturing, redesign. So the purpose is to promote resource efficiency through minimum waste generation, so that the resources that are once introduced into the economy, they are again and again utilized. So there is minimum waste generation, and it also aims to focus upon zero landfill. So it also aims to achieve the target of zero landfill. So it is a core working group is basically housed in the Ministry of Environment. So Interministerial National Resource Efficiency Board will be there to guide on the aspects of critical aspects critical to its implementations. So it offers tax benefits, as well as apart from setting material recovery facilities. So basically it aims to manage waste and provide green loans to small and medium enterprises, and soft loans to construct waste disposal facilities apart from setting up material recovery facilities. So basically, as you know that today the focus is on circular economy, so India is basically targeting towards it. So efficient resource management, minimizing landfill, and promoting reuse is the basic thing in it. So this is about your second question. Let's move into the third question. Sorry, the solution has already been appeared. So which of the following committees had recommended the post of Chief of Defence Staff? A. Deepak Parekh Committee, B. K. Subramaniam Committee, C. Rajiv Chopra Committee, D. None of the above. Let me tell you, friend, that the answer is K. Subramaniam Committee. So K. Subramaniam Committee was constituted post Kargil War. So basically to review the Kargil War and what was India, how was India's response, whether it was whether it, we had any limitations or not. So this basically committee, though did not, it directly did not said that the Chief of Defence Staff should be there, but it highlighted that there was lack of coordination among the three services in the beginning of the war. So that's why a group of ministers that were constituted to review the report of this committee, they recommended that there must be a Chief of Defence Staff. And now it has been announced by our Prime Minister on the Independence Day, on his Independence Day speech, that there will be a Chief of Defence Staff. So the answer would be B. So it it aims to provide the effective leadership at the top level and improve coordination among the tri-services. So it also has to act as single point advice to the executive, that is the Prime Minister. So this is all about more details. So you can see these details in the PDF, and we will provide you PDF. And next question is your, which of the following statements is correct? First, Araku Valley is popular hill station in Karnataka. Second, it is a part of Eastern Ghats. So we have to choose the correct statement. Let me tell you, friends, that here you can easily judge that either one will be correct or second will be correct, because Karnataka is on the western part of is on the western coastal west coast line and not on the east coast line. So either the first statement is correct or the second statement is correct. But let me tell you, friends, that the second statement is correct, because Araku Valley is basically in Andhra Pradesh, and it is, you can see, Andhra Pradesh is in the east coast, so it is not in Karnataka. So please note, this is Andhra Pradesh. So next question is fifth question. Let's move on to the fifth question. Fifth question is, consider the following statements related to Maritime Domain Awareness Project. First, National Maritime Domain Awareness Project was launched in accordance with the vision of Prime Minister on Saga, that is security and growth for all in the region. Second, Information Fusion Center Indian Ocean Region set up under National Maritime Domain Awareness Project is in the state of Kerala. So we have to choose that which of the above statements is correct. Let me tell you, friends, that the first statement is correct, and to some extent second statement is correct, but it is wrong to the extent that it says that this is based in Kerala. It is not based in Kerala, but it is based in Gurugram. So the first statement is correct. So basically the purpose of this National Maritime Domain Awareness Project is to enhance the awareness about our Indian Ocean region, and this information, and under it, National Maritime Domain Awareness, the Information Fusion Center and Information Fusion Center Indian Ocean Region has been set up. So basically this project was launched in accordance with the vision of Sagar. So what is Information Fusion Center? So it is basically, it aims to strengthen maritime security in the region and beyond by building a common coherent maritime situation picture and acting as a maritime information hub for the region. So it is based in Gurugram. So basically it provides information upon white shipping, and it is a single point center linking all coastal radar chains to generate a seamless real-time picture of the nearly 7500 kilometer coastline. So you can see that it has a responsibility of maintaining surveillance over the entire Indian coastline, so that proper information can flow about the security situation, about the different ships, that is about the commercial shipping as well as white shipping. So significance and need is to, as a diverse Indian Ocean region has a diverse set of littorals and island nations, each with their unique needs and aspirations, interests and values, and it is necessary to counter the rise in maritime piracy in region. So maritime piracy, so you might be aware of Somalian pirates. So they are quite unpopular for their piracy related activities, and also it ensures that the entire region is benefited by mutual collaboration, exchange of information and understanding the concerns and threats that are prevalent in Indian Ocean region. So why is Indian Ocean important? So you might see in the later in the explanation. Let's move to the sixth question. Sixth question is, consider the following statements related to Chandrayaan-2 moon mission. First, this is the first space mission to conduct soft landing on the south pole of the lunar body. Second, the polar satellite launch vehicle is used to launch the Chandrayaan-2 mission. So we have to choose which of the above statement is correct. So it is quite easy question. First is correct. First statement is correct, but the second is not correct, because GSLV MK3 is used for the launch of Chandrayaan-2, because Chandrayaan-2 as such is quite heavy, 3700 kg. So it would be difficult for the polar satellite launch vehicle to carry it. So GSLV was the vehicle that was used to launch it. So the answer is A, that is, it is the only first space mission to conduct soft landing on the south pole of the lunar body. So it has three parts with it, and basically it has an orbiter that will orbit around the moon, and it has in fact yesterday entered the lunar orbit, and then there is a lander that will soft land, that is Vikram, and then there will be a rover that will be doing reconnaissance over the lunar surface. So that rover is called Pragyan. So that is important thing. So GSLV MK3 is used. So basically, why explore lunar south pole? Because it is quite large, and it has not been explored till date, and it is also away from the sunlight radiation. So it is one of the most coldest regions of the moon. So there could be the possibility of water there. So evidence for water molecules that had been discovered by Chandrayaan-1 require further study. So that's why it is the soft landing on the south pole. Now let's move on to the seventh question. Seventh question is, consider the following statements related to biosimilars. First, they are chemically derived drugs used to treat human beings. Second, they can be manufactured by any company after the expiry of the patent of innovator of the drug. So we have to choose the correct statement. Let me tell you, friends, that both these statements are correct. These biosimilars are basically drugs that are used to treat the human beings, and they can be manufactured by any company once the innovator who had invented the drug, the patent of that innovator expires. So answer is C. So basically, biosimilars are those drugs which are derived from living organisms, for example human beings or different bacteria for the purpose of treatment. So they are generally derived from a living organism. So this is about your seventh question. Let's move on to the eighth question. Eighth question is, Dampa, Baksa, Palamau tiger reserves are being in news for the following reasons. First, record highest number of tigers in the recently conducted tiger survey. Second, has the highest tiger density among the tiger reserves present in the country. So which of the above statements is correct? So we have to choose that which of the above statements is correct. Let me tell you, friends, that the correct statement is your both statements are incorrect, because these are basically the tiger reserves that recently the tiger census was released by the National Tiger Conservation Authority, and it was found that Dampa, Baksa and Palamau tiger reserve do not have even single tiger. So solution is D. So did not register any presence of the striped big cat, and it is basically these Baksa tiger reserve is in West Bengal, Palamau is in Jharkhand, and Dampa is in Mizoram. Let's move on to ninth question. Ninth question is, according to the recent report released by NGO Greenpeace, consider the following statements. First, India is the largest emitter of anthropogenic sulfur dioxide in the world. Second, anthropogenic sulfur dioxide is emitted from the fertilizer industries, and it is known to contribute largely to air pollution. So we have to choose that which of the above statements is correct. So let me tell you, friend, that the first statement is correct. India, yes, recently this green piece and that is environmental NGO, it released the report, and India was found to be the largest emitter of anthropogenic sulfur dioxide, but its main source is burning of the fossil fuel, that is coal. So 15% of the hotspots that were, it basically hotspots were mapped all over the world that were hotspots in terms of sulfur dioxide emission. So 15% of the hotspots are there in India. So it is the largest emitter also. So which of the above statement is correct? So one only is correct. So the solution is A. So here is you can see that SO2 hotspots were detected by ozone monitoring instrument satellite. So please note this word, ozone monitoring instrument satellite, because this could be asked. So 15% were there, but in fact the largest SO2 emission hotspot is Norilsk smelter complex in Russia. and then how to control, basically how we can control with stricter norms, with shifting to renewable energy, and then using stricter we can say stricter action against coal power plants. So various actions have been taken in this regard. Let's move on to the last question of the day, the 10th question. Consider the following statements related to scheme of Pradhan Mantri Ujjwala Yojana. First, it aims to provide free LPG connections to all the households in the country. Second, the scheme will reduce the air pollution, particularly indoor air pollution, significantly. So which of the above statements is correct? So let me tell you, friends, that the only statement that is correct is first statement. Second statement. First statement is not correct, because LPG connections are will be provided to the households that are below poverty line. So free connection, one time connection is provided, free one time connection. So solution is B. So basically the families who are BPL under this socio-economic and caste census, they are eligible. So a financial assistance of rupees 1600 per connection is given by the center. So basically focus is to improve the health of the women and the children, and reducing serious health hazards associated to solid fuel, that is based on fossil fuel, and reducing the morbidity and morbidity as well as mortality relating to this usage of solid fuel. So why it is important? Because India suffers from high household air pollution, which is also called indoor air pollution. So in fact, Ministry of Health and Welfare places HAP as the second leading risk factor contributing to India's disease burden. So this is a significant statement. Please note this statement. This such type of statements help you in mains. So this is the second leading factor contributing to diseases in India, as is recognized by Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. And then WHO also find that 13% of morbidity and mortality is related to this solid usage of solid fuel. And then there is issue of 40% pulmonary, all pulmonary disorders, and nearly 30% of the cataract incidences, and 20% each of ischemic heart disease, lung cancer, and lower respiratory infection are associated with this problem. So friends, this is all about today's questions. If you like the video, if you like the questions, then do ensure that you like our video, share it with your friends, because ultimately we depend upon you people so that we can also promote our work. So obviously if you help us and motivate us to work, then only we will be able to continue with all these series. And lastly, friends, we have a Telegram channel also. You can visit on this Telegram channel, on which we update multiple things that we post on our YouTube channel. So also we can visit our website, that is www.achieveias.co.in, where we upload daily articles that are of relevance from your current affair point of view. So you can visit our website, and lastly, if you want the PDF of this discussion, then you can mail us at achieveias21@gmail.com, or you can also contact us here, that is 8968920720. Basically it is a paid subscription, so we are just keeping the minimum price for this series, that is rupees 99 per month. So if in case you are willing to buy this daily discussion PDF for rupees 99 per month, then you can contact us. The link of subscription will also be provided in the description box. In any case, you don't want to contact us, then you can check the description box and can check the link, and can use that link for joining our this initiative of PDFs. So basically this amount has been kept as minimum as possible for the purpose of your affordability and for the purpose of our motivation. So this is all about today's video. Do ensure that you subscribe to our channel. So thank you. Have a very nice day ahead.